Airing on Asheville FM, 103.3 LPFM in Asheville, this is The Final Straw Radio, a weekly anarchist and anti-authoritarian broadcast and podcast emanating out of occupied Chalagi land in southern Appalachia. We bring you voices and perspectives from projects and struggles all around the world, and you can find our archives, transcripts, ways to follow us and support us at thefinalstrawradio.noblogs.org. We're sharing an interview with Joan Braune, author of Understanding and Countering Fascist Movements from Void to Hope, out this year from Rutledge. In this chat, we talk about understanding fascism and fascists, motivations and deterrence, the framework of de-radicalization, the role of former fascists in education around fascism, and the importance of fostering anti-fascist movements. The Final Straw is a proud member of the Channel Zero Network of Anarchist Podcasts, and here's a jingle from another member of CZN.
People need ordering principles. 12 Rules for What is a podcast about fascism and the far right from the perspective of the left. It's obviously great stuff, but don't take our word for it. Here is a word from our sponsor.
I'm Jordan Peterson. Now that I have been injected with the anti-fascist super soldier serum, I renounce all my rubbish beliefs about hierarchies and the distribution of sex and dedicate my life, my soul, to the 12 Rules. What podcast?
So that's 12 Rules for What? A podcast about the far right. Get it anywhere you get your podcasts.
12 Rules
for What? I'm joined by Joan Braune, author of Understanding and Countering Fascist Movements from Void to Hope, out this year from Rutledge. God, okay. Out this year from Rutledge, as well as the forthcoming The Ethics of Researching the Far Right. Joan is a lecturer in philosophy at Gonzaga University in Spokane, Washington. Thank you so much for joining me, Joan.
Thanks for having me.
My pleasure. When thinking on show topics a few months ago, I got an itch to have an interview around the end of 2023 with the 2024 elections in mind, to chat on the show about fascist psychology and how white folks could talk to the racists that they might have in their extended family around the dinner table during that holiday-rich season at the end of the year. After this bounced around in my head a little bit, but I didn't really have any good examples of organizations to reach out to or individuals, I heard your chat on Yana Passeron, a podcast out of so-called Melbourne, and it really touched on some questions that I've been wrestling with. So I'm really happy to have gotten a chance to talk to you now and also to read your book. Can you talk a bit about the working definition of fascism that you're employing in the book and what common liberal narratives miss when talking about fascists, their movements, and their motivations?
Yes. So in the book, I talk about fascism as having two dimensions that we need to understand simultaneously. Fascism is a social movement seeking power, and it's always already connected to sources of power on the one hand. So that means it has media organs, it has candidates, it has money, it has networks of funding and advertising and sharing its ideas. And at the same time, fascism is also a movement that's composed of individuals who have particular reasons, both in terms of the structure of society and the structure of the economic system and of oppression in society, and also their own personal life circumstances that are leading them into that movement. So essentially, I was arguing we have to look at both of these dimensions in order to defeat fascism in the long run. Liberal conceptions of fascism often miss the degree to which it is connected to power and embedded in structures of oppression and violence in society. And so when we think about fields like hate studies or even quote unquote terrorism studies, which is not what I do at all, we notice that often these fields are very white. Often they exclude a more structural or radical analysis. And there's a reason for that, because of how fascism gets defined and seen as a form of extremism or criminality or something on the edge of society, or maybe just a sort of attitude that some people have that they can be trained out of. And we're missing the structural element of that. So in the book, I talk about fascist ideology and how it's difficult to define, because fascists fundamentally are not entirely coherent in their worldview, and there's some adaptability to the worldview. So it's difficult to define. And what I suggest is kind of a grab bag approach, where you get a list of maybe 30 or so common properties, and you look at movements and you look at historical events, and you start to see what these movements and events have in common. But I would say pretty crucial to fascism is a belief in a natural hierarchy in the world, that some people are more worthy than others, stronger, better, more deserving of power, that some people are lower in that hierarchy and need to be subjugated or eliminated, and a belief that violence has a kind of cleansing power, that violence is not just a means to an end, but a good in itself that can help these corrupt people come to power. Also, it has a cyclical vision of history. So it believes that the world has to be destroyed and remade, and that they're going to be the heroes that are at the vanguard of this destruction and rebirth. I think that's a pretty good start. So what I looked at the worldview issues, right? The ideology issues. I looked at social movements. And then I tried to figure out kind of individually, how are all these things intersecting? How are individuals entering into these movements? Because I think we need to strategically be thinking about that so we can be preventing it. And I think if we're thinking correctly about preventing it, it's not actually going to lead us to a sort of focus on identifying people and surveilling and looking for radicalization factors, but it actually leads us to a more radical analysis of society and a critique of capitalism if we really understand the forces that are creating the alienation that makes people susceptible to this kind of recruitment.
I guess on the individual side of it, yeah, I see what you mean around like the criminalization of the subject that veers in this unhealthy or unsavory direction. And there's also psychologization of that individual. Mm-hmm. Like that, for instance, when there have been racist motivated mass shootings, oftentimes the individual is declared to have mental health issues that's correlated with their political ideology. And that sort of, and they may have both, right? Those may be two things that are going on. And I would argue that to do that to a lot of people, like, says something about your mental stability, but it also loses the step of, it makes it an easy to identify other that is well outside of the safe boundaries of how society operates. And I think the point that you make in the book about how we live in a society that is rife with misogyny, anti-Semitism, racism, white supremacy, settler colonialist society, I could go on, ableist, and all of those, like, feel like you could see those germinations as just fully blossoming in the fascist identity. Can you talk a little bit about how maybe that also that part of the liberal analysis refuses to look in its own backyard or at its own roots?
Right. Yeah. And I think both of those things can be looked at together. And so, like, I come out of the tradition of Frankfurt School critical theory. I wrote my dissertation on Eric Fromm, who was a psychoanalyst as well as a Marxist philosopher and activist. And I think if we look at what drives people, one of the ways we can get past the narrow focus on just defining fascism by a system of beliefs is we have to look at the fact that people are not fully honest with themselves or with the public about what's bringing them into these movements. So there's an element of dishonesty that I think is very hard to unravel, even with formers who have left these movements. They don't always know how to analyze their own motivations, because there's so much unconscious stuff going on and so much of a desire to just justify violence or justify bullying. But at the same time, yes, you know, it's absolutely structural. And, you know, there's a question about why this appears as what the philosopher William James calls a live option, right? There are some things that are live options in our lives and there are some that aren't, right? Like, it's just never occurred to me to convert to Hinduism. You know, I nothing against it. It's just never occurred to me, right? But there are things in my life where I'm like, oh, I'm weighing these various possibilities. Like, I come from an interfaith family. My mom's Jewish. My dad's Catholic. You know, so I've kind of thought about, like, oh, which do I identify with or neither, right? And so why is fascism occurring to people as a live option in the political scene, right? And it has to be able to resonate with people, because these attitudes are more widespread in society than simply those who embrace this consciously. When fascists were talking about normalization and becoming normal looking and so forth early in the Trump administration, like covering up your tattoos, looking very clean cut, running for Republican offices, just being the boy or girl next door, that kind of thing. The reason they're able to do that is because we have already, you know, such deep racist, sexist, violent, anti-Semitic, et cetera, ideology in our society. So it's very easy for them to translate that into more acceptable political slogans like build the wall, right? So it's, yeah, it's expressing attitudes that are already present and already empowered in society.
Could you talk a little bit for the book, what methods you've used to attain data on which you base your views on motivations and demotivations of fascists?
Yeah, everything that I looked at was very public. So I have great admiration for people that do sort of underground investigation with sock puppet accounts and things like that. But I did not do that. So I was looking at very public data, looking at people's YouTube videos, people's tweets, articles. I went back and read some of the literature that they've read and some of their propaganda. I also did interview a few formers, but that was not particularly formative for the research. A lot of my thinking about formers was based on critiquing and reading the work people had written and seeing the gaps, seeing what wasn't addressed, seeing the assumptions that were made and trying to question why those assumptions were being made. Looking, for example, at the ways people often interview formers and then just present the interview itself as evidence and like a kind of certainty that people are correctly analyzing their own situation and analyzing the movements they were part of. So to some degree, it's critical in that sense. I was doing kind of critique of what I was reading and what was missing. And then also just looking at like a ton of just public material. And, you know, well, and also I could say, you know, like I'm trained as a philosopher. I'm trained as a critical theorist and a philosopher. And so a lot of what I'm doing is analyzing ideas and trying to look at how people's ideas interact with their worldview and their social position and their psychology. So it's more based on, how should I put this? It's like more theoretical than it is like quantitative or something, right? It's a qualitative study, it's theoretical.
But some of the philosophers that you were pulling from also had done work around, like including survey work, right, around fascists and their belief systems in the World War II and post-World War II era, right?
Yeah, yeah. So I used quite a bit of Fromm, and Fromm wrote a really interesting book called Anatomy of Human Destructiveness. He wrote a number of books on fascism, but that was his book where he really did a bunch of case studies of various Nazis. Some of them might be more legit than others. Apparently, he was a little naive about Albert Speer, but there's a lot of interesting data in that book, and there are a lot of other people kind of doing that work. Fromm had a theory of social character, as he calls it, and he's really trying to find a way theoretically to get past both a really reductive kind of Marxism that would see people's social attitudes as just mechanically produced by their economic situation and challenge the limitations of Freud and Freud's authoritarianism and sexism and so on, and try to find a way to think about how people's individual circumstances interact with their social circumstances. So he's really good at that, and I was trying to do that a bit. I also have a chapter drawing on Simone Weil, who was a social critic and Christian mystic, but also coming out of a Jewish background like Fromm. And it was super interesting to see how they had a very similar analysis of fascism that they arrived at very independently of each other, that they both saw certain factors in society causing alienation and a sense of void or absence in life that people were needing to fill, and how fascism was offering to fill that for people, and how the way that it was offering to fill that by just presenting an ideology as a solution to your life problems drives these cycles of violence as people become more determined to defend this thing that their whole life meaning depends upon.
So that void being in the subtitle, From Void to Hope, right? And so the conception, I'm going to mix up whether Vi or Fromm had said which, because you kind of go back and forth between, but like that narrative, I think, is the narrative that somebody is drawn towards this extreme ideology is very much based on a hole that's in themselves, is very much a framework that we're told about when somebody chooses something that is outside of the norm. You were explaining that in some terms, people might approach finding this void, being told that they have this void, and explained what this void is by a fascist ideologue. And they create this idol that they use to attempt to compensate the void. They try to like fill the void with this version of themselves, this story, this identity of themselves that they make up or that they accept. But that because fascism is one of constant destruction for the sake of creation, it just becomes a maw that opens wider and wider. Does that about break down like part of the idea of the critique of that approach towards identity?
For sure. Yeah. I think one of the things I emphasize there is there's a process of sort of waiting and uncertainty in determining your life identity. And especially if we're talking about people who are being recruited at really young ages, which is often the case, like people are often joining these movements as teenagers or preteens. And this, none of this excuses it in any way, of course, right? This is a life choice that people are making that they can and should be held accountable for, and that causes tremendous harm. But if we're trying to figure out how to prevent it and understanding that dynamic, I think about young people and teenagers, like teenagers, for example, going to the mall and trying on a bunch of different outfits, right? It's like, am I a punk? Am I a goth, right? You're like trying on these identities. And part of becoming a mature person in the world is like realizing that you can adopt that particular meaning or identity or whatever if you want, but it doesn't fundamentally solve the question of who you are. And that's a sort of choice that we have to make. It's some kind of existential choice that nobody can ultimately make for us. And so I worry when I think about quote unquote de-radicalization, which is not my favorite word, because I think radicalization is good if you're radicalizing in the right way. But when I think about de-radicalization or getting people out of these movements, it feels like people are missing the fact that you don't arrive at an identity by just picking a different thing off the shelf or picking out a different set of clothes. Because that's kind of what got people into this in the first place, right? They're like, I'm just going to pick this because this is going to give me an outlet for my rage. It's going to give me an explanation for a world that I find scary and confusing. And I don't think we can just substitute that with something else. There's an element of having to learn to think for yourself and be patient with reality and explore, you know? So Fromm and Vey, I think, are very good at understanding that you can't just fill the void. You have to kind of wait and see what appears and what appears to be true in your life.
Or move through it was one way that it was put in the book that I really appreciated. And as someone who's like most of us have experienced, for instance, grief and loss, and everyone deals with it differently. But I've found that the ways to do that are to just sort of like sit with it and then come out the other side. It's a part of you. It's not something that you move past necessarily. You put it in your bag of stuff that's on your back. But if the fascist mentality or like another sort of identity is an avoidance of the complexity of life and the difficulty of having to create your own identity and think for yourself, as you say, or the fascist identity is, I think, as Fromm said, is an escape from freedom, then it's embracing that freedom, the responsibility that comes with it, and the scary, beautiful part of having to actually construct a complex life, because this is the one you have to live.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I think grief and loss is such a great example of that. In my own research around fascism and some of the things that I've seen happen to people, you know, I've had to grapple with some stuff myself and nobody really prepared me for that, you know, like, because I, you know, if you're training in maybe psychology or something like that, probably in graduate school, there's some course on like what to do when the research gets sad. But nobody did that in philosophy because they were just like, go read Immanuel Kant and tell us what it means. And so I had to think a lot in my own life too about like, how do we build community? How do we sustain? How do we find meaning when things are bleak? And I think that's really important for everyone. Like, it's an ongoing process and our movements need to be thinking about that.
Absolutely. See, so one major critique that sparked my interest in that discussion on Yana Passeron was the development of a world of countering violence extremism, or CVE. Can you talk about that industry, its relation to police, military, and counterinsurgency studies, hearkening like through and beyond the war on terror era, and some of the concerns that you have around this framework for addressing fascist movements?
Definitely. Yeah, I think there's a real absence of, not a total absence, but there's a need for more analysis on this. And it's often kind of surprising to me how many anti-fascist news outlets and podcasts are kind of missing this, because there's often a critique of policing on the one hand, which is important and essential, and there's a critique of fascism on the other. And what we're missing sometimes is, in between that space, there is a whole industry, as you said, a whole network that includes government, law enforcement, militarism, of people who are doing both hard and soft power, as they would call it, or sometimes the in-groupy language among these people is they're doing squishy methods. So they're doing this kind of soft power, counter-radicalization, counter-insurgency, trying to figure out how do we identify radicalization factors, this kind of language. We've seen particularly scary versions of this in the UK, because the UK has a program called Prevent. And Prevent is Islamophobic. It was from the start. It was very much focused on targeting Muslims. At various points in its history, it's tried to present itself as more neutral and as also targeting neo-Nazis. And it's presented this targeting of neo-Nazis for surveillance or prevention as a way of saying, oh, you know, we're not targeting Muslims or we're not targeting people of color. But of course, you know, with any kind of program like this, it's primarily people of color and people from other marginalized communities that get targeted. But essentially what happens is people get tracked into this system of ongoing surveillance, right? Because you have to kind of meet with social workers, you have to meet with psychologists and police for often like a 7-year period. You're left in this file system. And so there have been kids that have been tracked into this because every doctor, every therapist, every teacher is a mandated reporter of radicalization signs. So there was like a little kid, for example, whose teacher asked, like, what would you do if you had $1 million? And the little kid said, I would give alms to the poor. And the teacher heard that as arms to the poor and said, oh, this little boy wants to arm the poor. And reported the kid to the government. And so the kid was in this system for years, right? So this is really, you know, I've been talking to people in the UK that have been fighting this, and there are a lot of Muslim scholars there that are doing amazing work. But we need to be watching that this kind of thing is not spreading and worsening. And it definitely is. Like, we're seeing this kind of thing all over the place. Definitely scary watching this, the Stop Cop City protesters being labeled as domestic terrorists. That kind of language, even when it's not a criminal charge or criminal classification, is something we need to be super careful about on the left, because oftentimes you'll hear these appeals when there's a mass shooting or something like that. People will say, well, we need to call this what it is. We need to call it terrorism. We need to call it radicalization. We need to call it extremism. It's not just, you know, ISIS and so forth. White supremacists are terrorists. They're extremists. And that's not always helpful, because what you're doing is you're just creating further empowerment of a system that tracks and surveils Muslims, people of color, and others.
Particularly in that instance, too, like when those terrorism charges that are being brought up by the state of Georgia created the category of terrorist that's being applied to the Stop Cop City people in response to the shooting in South Carolina that Dylann Roof conducted at the Emmanuel AME Church of black parishioners, a literal white supremacist incel bowl cut head kid goes in after attending a few church Bible study meetings with folks, goes back in with weapons and does this. And now this is being applied against people that have not hurt anyone, that are blocking the construction of an institution that is like inherently violent against people of color in a black neighborhood.
Yeah.
So,
yep. No, yeah, that's absolutely right. Yeah. And it's that kind of language is always going to get weaponized. And when we're thinking about soft power, first of all, we can't be taking grants from the Department of Homeland Security. Like, I'm sorry, but like I've run into so many like nice nonprofits trying to figure out how to survive that are doing work against hate in their communities that are like, ah, the sparkly money. You cannot take that money. You cannot take that counter-extremism, countering violent extremism, CVE money. Now they're calling it something else, targeted violence prevention. It's the same thing. When there are petitions signed by the Council on American Islamic Relations, the Brennan Center for Justice, all of these organizations that track civil liberties and work on civil liberties for marginalized communities saying, please do not take this money. When you take that money, you're breaking the trust that you should be building with communities under attack. And so that's also been like a ongoing conversation I keep having with different people in the world of research and activism around hate groups is like, please do not take that money. It's counter to what your mission professes to be for many of these organizations. And then you get these really weird astroturfy, like counterinsurgency type things popping up that are funded by these, you know, programs, DHS money. Like there's a thing I think is very peculiar that I've not done a lot of research on yet, but there's a network called Cure Portland or Cure PDX. And it's an offshoot of Parallel Networks, which was the group that founded Light Upon Light, which I think we were going to get to later. But Light Upon Light was this extremely sketchy, alleged de-radicalization group that actually ended up whitewashing the reputations of various active fascists and neo-Nazis like Matt Heimbach. And it was co-founded by this guy, Jesse Morton, who was former supporter of a like fundamentalist Muslim propaganda outlet who had gone to prison and had gotten a deal and gotten released and who was rather unstable to be generous. I've heard all kinds of things about Jesse Morton, but Jesse Morton passed a few years ago, but it was co-founded by Jesse Morton and a guy from the New York City Police Department, Mitch Silber, created this group, Parallel Networks, and then it was called Light Upon Light. And the latest iteration of that project is called Cure Portland, and it focuses on Portland. And it's basically squishy, soft counterinsurgency. It's like, we're going to talk about how to make sure the anti-fascists and the fascists get along. Nobody punches anybody. Everybody finds ways to talk to each other productively. And you simply can't fix fascism with that kind of, like, with dialogue and reaching across the aisle. Like, that is not, that's not how you address a social movement that wants to eliminate people. So, I mean, yeah, there are certainly a range of tactics you can use, but it's definitely more than understanding one another's worldview, respect and dialogue, right? It's very naive and really pretty dangerous to teach people that that's fundamentally how social change happens.
Yeah, and that kind of made me think of dating back to the 90s. The It Did Happen Here podcast and book talk a bit about the police approaches towards, in particular, like anti-racist skinheads at a time when there was a lot of violent fascist skinhead organizing, and not just skinheads, but racist organizing, the clashes that would occur between them for control over social scenes, over cultural centers and spaces, as well as for the like self-defense and also the defense of marginalized and targeted communities. The police was dealing, you know, was literally claiming that they were looking at this as being a skinhead or a gang problem and not an issue of a fascist insurgency that is targeting specific parts of the population, racialized or gendered parts of the population that they had a problem with. Similarly, like, so this is kind of like echoes of the past, it seems like.
Definitely. Yeah. It's not new. And, you know, I think it just kind of gets constantly rebranded. And after 9/11, it was able to get support from some liberals because it was presented as this, like, you know, like we can prevent these things without going to war, right? Like, we're just going to surveil people. We're going to look for these things. And then we're going to, like, very, you know, gently make them talk to social workers or something, or we're going to arrest them, right? But it's not, soft power is still part of the same system. And you're not really, you're not defeating fascism if you continue to support the same institutions that target the same people fascism targets. And I think it's I think it's good to use the term gangs, because that's an issue too, the sort of viewing it as just like it's gangs. And then it gets sort of, even though police departments don't seem to treat these things as gangs normally, they're not in like the gang databases usually or whatever, insisting that these things really are gangs too, is the same sort of language that I hear that's problematic, where people are saying it really is terrorism too. And then you just expand these like problematic gang databases, you expand the problematic targeting and prosecution and so on of people of color and others.
Yeah. Yeah. And I've like having talked to some anarchists and anti-fascists in prison too, more and more they're coming across. And this is not a new thing. Also, the Oregon Department of Corrections was doing this in the late 90s, early 2000s, of criminalizing people who have used a circle A on their literature or letters or whatever as the part of the anarchist gang. Apparently they're doing this in Ohio and other places.
I've seen people do that. Yeah. I've seen cops give those kinds of presentations. You know, there's a conference now called Eradicate Hate that I refuse to go to, but it's held every year in Pittsburgh now. I heard some horror stories from the first one. But that aside, even if they kind of get better at managing, making sure that no one is harmed in any kind of terrible way, I really, if you look at that lineup of people, there are some people on the list of speakers that they invite that are pretty good, but it's very heavily white. It's very heavily law enforcement focused. It's very heavily focused on CVE, and groups like Parents for Peace, you know, are sort of held up as the solution, that these de-radicalization groups are going to save us.
Yeah, it seems like the harms that are allowed are the ones that are institutionalized and publicly funded. If you want to support The Final Straw Radio, you can subscribe to our podcast via various platforms, follow, rate, and share our materials online, and learn more at tfsr.wtf. And if you'd like to fund our transcription work that allows for easier translation, more accessibility of content, and the zines that we produce from each interview, consider picking up some merch from us or making a one-time or recurring donation via PayPal, Venmo, Stripe, or LibrePay, or joining our Patreon to access early release content and other goodies via the links that you can find at tfsr.wtf/support. This is totally off topic, but I remember seeing this last week a lot of footage of, and I guess probably because they appeared on Fox News, but in New York, Guardian Angels, which is a thing that I had not heard about for as an organization for a couple of decades, but I remember them being touted as an autonomous community response in Los Angeles and in other places where there was viewed to be a lot of street violence going on, basically like a paramilitary street fighting response to public crime fears of a bunch of biker dudes wearing the same jackets and little berets, like purple berets, walking around and sort of intimidating people. This doesn't have to be in the recording, but they seem to get like a lot of institutional support, and they're basically jackbooted thugs that tend to focus on the same marginalized communities that are always accused of being the sources of criminality or whatever in our society. I don't know. That doesn't have to go anywhere, but
I've got to think about how to connect it a little bit, because, you know, some of the people I'm criticizing in the CVE world are, you know, would shun that sort of approach as extremism in itself. But one of the signs of fascism that a lot of people look for is, do you have paramilitaries? And gosh, like that is.
Is it the Guardian Angels? Is it the Proud Boys that politicians are using as their personal security? Like,
yeah, exactly. Like, you know, I think, you know, like Matt Shea, who was a local politician and state legislator here, who's now a pastor with, I don't think, any kind of pastoral training, but just decided to transition from one to the other as part of his Christian nationalist agenda. I definitely remember, you know, people like saying, you know, he's guarded by a militia. You know, I've seen, there's a lot of militia activity up here in general. I'm in the Pacific Northwest, and militias, militias get involved with politicians. They get involved with political organizations. And then we look at what's happening on the border in Texas right now, that kind of thing, really, really scary to me to see that kind of like, oh, like let's get the National Guard teaming up with like whatever the newest version of the Minutemen is, right? These like border, self-deputized border guards.
And this was happening particularly at Eagle Pass, where there were militia coming. I know that there were militia from North Carolina that were showing up out there and like giving aid to the police, but also showing up. And I think the FBI was like infiltrated and just brought charges against one militia person for having explosives. I think that they were meaning to start some sort of conflict that would force the federal government's hands. But anyway.
Yeah. One thing that I think people should start looking at, by the way, you can use this or not use this, but somebody's got to do a project looking at targeting of the homeless or the unhoused, because that's, you know, a space where I think there's not enough research being done. And a lot of people think about it as, oh, that's just, it's one of those things that just gets categorized as crime rather than hate crime. And so it doesn't get tracked and looked at as fascist activity. But even when you're on websites like Nextdoor or, you know, these kind of like neighborhood watch websites, you can see people promoting attacks and fascist activity. And I had a sociologist friend who did her dissertation on looking at like a Facebook group that was just like photographing homeless people and like basically targeting homeless people. So even just, you know, a small neighborhood of people that are like, we're going to go down there with our guns on our motorcycles. And then like, how do the cops react and how does the city react? You know, it's just a space where people are very vulnerable.
It's also oftentimes around rhetoric of public health as well as small business operation. And like, I don't know, there's all sorts of directions you could go about around pointing to the fascistic. Like, yeah, here we've got organizations that like not like non-institutional organizations are just like gatherings of people on like social media that coordinate and fundraise around increasing police on the streets and increasing police budgets and like attempting to coordinate businesses to complain about how dangerous quote unquote downtown Asheville is because there's people spanging or street musicians. And so it's never like a discussion of, hey, how come there are so many people that are homeless in your community? How come there's no public restrooms? How come there's no like resources available for people, drop-in centers or addiction help or public mental health, if that is a concern of yours. Instead, it's about like these people are scaring away my customers.
Yeah, I talked a little bit in the book about this documentary that was put out by a news channel in Seattle called Seattle is Dying, and deeply fascistic. I mean, if people know what to look for in fascist propaganda, I mean, the homeless are referred to as animals. The heroes are these, you know, small business owners, these, you know, upstanding, disempowered small business owners who just, they're producing all of the wealth in society and they're just not being protected from these animal-like homeless people. It's just, it was such fascist rhetoric. And then we had our own version of it put out here in Spokane. The following year, a Spokane documentary attacking the homeless. And it led to the election of a mayor whose entire platform was just targeting the homeless, who had no experience, was just a newscaster, but was elected by her Republican base based on promising to drive the homeless out of town.
It's a distinctly American problem, I think. And just to touch back on, I think Matt Shea, I was trying to look it up real quick, but I think Matt Shea was maybe the focus of the sequel to the Bundyville podcast series that came out from Oregon Public Radio.
Yes.
Bundyville, The Remnant, which is, I would suggest listeners listen to. I thought it was really well produced. And
yeah, it's very good. Leah Sotilli. She's a journalist from Spokane. She did some really great research on Matt Shea. And also Jason Wilson in The Guardian played a huge role in exposing Matt Shea's shenanigans.
I'll link those folks in the show notes. We've already kind of touched on it, but in the book, you take umbrage on employing terms like radicalization and extremism when defining, like, when either individuals or when the government or nonprofits or whatever define fascistic movements, groups, or individuals in those sorts of ways. Myself as an anti-government extremist in support of organizing by Black identity extremists also have some concerns. I wonder if you could just talk about, like, the sort of the stickiness of those terms, radicalization and extremism, and again, what that means to other forms of organizing or visions of the world, like leftists, for instance.
Definitely. It's based on a very Cold War mentality that sees, there was originally like an anti-communist Cold War mentality of basically anyone on the left can be equated on this ideological view with anyone on the extreme or far right, that fascists and communists are sort of equated as basically the same. And extremism comes out of that.
The horseshoe theory.
Horseshoe theory. Exactly. Yeah. Like, there was a book that was very popular in the 50s by this guy, Eric Hoffer, called The True Believer. There are a few things in the book that I think are kind of insightful, but communists and fascists are like identical to him, right? So it's like everyone in both of these categories has a black and white worldview, you know, is scared of outside information, inherently violent, all of this stuff, right? So it equates, and it's like sort of early radicalization factors theory, which is usually basically junk science. And Hoffer did not do any empirical research to come up with this list. It was based on, you know, his reading of books and his personal reflection. He was just a working class guy, which makes me want to like him, but it's a terrible book. So this has just kind of developed over the decades, you know, coming out of the Cold War and prior to that too, with, you know, if you even go back to like the targeting of the Wobblies by the FBI, that kind of thing, anti-labor, you know, suppression of labor movements and anarchist movements throughout US history. But it's been built up into this whole theory and this whole series of people doing research and these think tanks that do rely on a horseshoe theory, that fail to look at ideology and have a whole bunch of justifications for why ideology and ideological differences should be ignored. For example, one of the hot terms right now is accelerationism. And there's a whole new think tank that looks at what accelerationism might mean. And again, you know, some of the research is good, but if we think about accelerationism as some sort of wanting to speed up change or wanting to dramatically, you know, do some kind of upheaval, or we can just very quickly fail to make any sort of distinction between fascists and anarchists and communists and ISIS and Black Lives Matter and so on, right? You could just like start lumping everything into this sort of loose understanding of like, this is what the dangerous extremist looks like. They have a utopian vision. They want immediate change. They think there are enemies. They feel under attack. And it's like, you have to look at the actual details of people's beliefs and their actual, and the reality of their situation. Like, a white supremacist who feels under attack for being white and has a victim mentality is very different from a person who feels under attack because they really are under attack because they're black or trans or whatever, right? So if you're not doing that, if you're just looking at these sort of general factors, then you're ignoring whether people are in touch with the truth, whether people are fighting for emancipation or for oppression, right? And all of those distinctions matter a lot.
What is the role of formers in quote unquote de-radicalization as an industry or as a nonprofit sphere? And can you talk about some of the dangers of instilling the sort of power into the hands of former, quote unquote, former fascists that this can cause? I'd love if you could talk a bit about Light Upon Light a little bit more with Shope and Heimbach debacle. Like, I'll just say that, like, I, at one point, what was it, like 2 years ago, 3 years ago, I appeared on a David Robicks podcast as a guest. A couple of weeks later, and then there was discussion about, like, okay, cool, well, David Robicks identifies as an anarchist, does David Robicks want to, Like, here's some of the guests that David's had. Should David come on and maybe join some of the podcast networks that our project is a part of? And someone was like, David Rovick's just had Matthew Heimbach of the Traditionalist Workers Party on the show saying that he was a former. And dialoguing, like, David's like public discourse around people having concerns around this person not telling the truth and concerning platforming an individual who hasn't done a lot of, like, hasn't shown a lot of remorse or attempting to, like, undo, if that's even possible, some of the harm that he's been involved with was pretty disdainful.
Yeah, he's still a fascist.
Yeah, he's a national syndicalist now, or whatever. He was tabling some national syndicalist stuff at that, the pro-Russian rally that happened in D.C. last year.
Anyway. Yeah. National syndicalist. Sounds like national socialist. So creative. Yeah. I just wanted to hammer that because I don't want anyone to be confused that Matt Heimbach is even trying to not be a fascist. He's still a fascist. He's still organizing for fascism. And, you know, I've been helped by Alexander Reed Ross's book Against the Fascist Creep. I think it's really important to, you know, be aware of the way that fascism will try to masquerade as leftist. You know, and I'm seeing, for example, fascists trying to capitalize on the war right now and trying to push anti-Semitism by claiming they're just anti-Zionist. And of course, anti-Zionism is not the same thing as anti-Semitism, but it can be. and so you've got people kind of exploiting this moment in that way. And Matt Heimbach was like really good at that. And Traditionalist Workers Party in general was really trying to do that, really trying to sort of say, oh, like we, you know, we're so concerned about workers and we're so concerned about the poor. And but it was a fascist white supremacist group involved in Charlottesville, et cetera.
And you pointed out, too, that it's like it was a Strasserite organization, which is the whole red brown thing. So that's
Right. Right. Which can be very confusing for people if they don't know to watch for that. So I'll see people say things about fascist groups online or fascist figures, and they're like, oh, but they're right on this or whatever. And we have to be able to look at the whole picture and not just cherry pick issues. Like people periodically would when Tucker Carlson was on Fox News, people would periodically be like, oh, but he said this good thing. And it's like, but if you put it in the context of his entire worldview. But anyway, yeah. So Matt Heimbach reached out to Light Upon Light some time ago, I guess it was probably 2019, something like that. And Shane Burley did some digging and found, I think, the original letter that Heimbach sent to Light Upon Light, in which he said, I am not apologizing and will never apologize. And in response to that letter, Light Upon Light, Jesse Morton, who's since passed, decided to immediately call up the New York Times and say, I've got this amazing former for you. He's so famous and you've got to interview Matt Heimbach. And literally the guy is contacting Light Upon Light saying, yeah, kind of, you know, trying out something new, but definitely never apologizing. Right. And, you know, I don't know if we know the full story of what was going on with that and why he wanted to talk to Light Upon Light, but Light Upon Light was platforming various people that were far right. And so it would have been a way for him to get a wider audience and not really change, just sort of redefine maybe the name of his ideology, which he seems to be doing anyway. But, you know, they routinely, for example, promoted this incel podcast, far right incel podcast. So they were far right group in lots of ways. And then Jeff Scoop, who you mentioned, who was head of the National Socialist Movement for like 20 plus years, reached out to them also, you know, and tried to present himself as a former, and then eventually moved away and formed his own network and his own platform. And this is there's more to this story than I think we know. So it's hard to say exactly what's going on with Scoop, but I would say, I mean, for many people, a hard line is, did you rat out your buddies, you know, or did you try to dismantle and attack the group you were part of? And Scoop, by a lot of standards, has not done that. So, for example, he continued to defend himself in the Charlottesville lawsuit and tried to not have to pay his portion instead of working with the lawyers on the lawsuit, which you should do, right? If you're a former and you're truly sorry for having participated in the Charlottesville hate march, like you would want to help the people with their lawsuit and turn over information to them. And that did not happen. So that for a lot of people was like sign number one, that this is not someone who can be trusted. And then he continues to promote with his new so-called de-radicalization platform, people that, you know, I would consider to be far right. Like there's this guy in the UK who, as far as I can tell, just sort of like redefined himself from like, just maybe switched on the topic of anti-Semitism, but still holds all of his other far right views, and very racist, very anti-immigrant. And, you know, Scoop is promoting him as a former and all of this stuff. So it's very scary. And then it's hard to get the timelines. I'll say this because I don't want to say anything that I can't back up. It's very hard to get the timelines of when people are reaching out to somebody like Scoop and then when they're appearing on his podcast. And it looks super fast. Like there's one person I was just looking at actually the other day who was tweeting out fascist propaganda like within the last month. And now she's tweeting with Scoop that she's going to be on the podcast apologizing within the next few weeks. And it's like, that's soon. Like there's a process to this, right? Like,
yeah, it's not like their tweet deck was just preloaded with this stuff and they forgot to turn them off. Like, oh, shoot, that's embarrassing. Right.
I doubt it was that. Yeah, I doubt it was just that she forgot to click something. So we'll see. But
a really good point that you make in the book is that a lot of the reasons that people, well, institutions that hold a lot of authority in our society say that forgiveness is, and this is a very, as you pointed out in the Yana Passeron discussion, which I thought was really like on point, very Christian value is forgiveness in a very shallow manner.
Yes.
It's promoted by these organizations, and it's a narrative that fits really well into the hegemonic discussion that our society has around participation, around belonging, around family, these sorts of things. And it allows groups like Light Upon Light to launder individuals that continue the same activities and don't, like to quote the slogan for One People Project, if hate has consequences, like there's no consequences besides like 5 seconds of embarrassment saying, I'm sorry that I did a thing, JK. But it's a really easy thing for it lets not only like quote unquote formers, the people claiming to be formers, but it also lets the audience or the receiver of that narrative off of the hook. We get to feel good when we open up space and say, this person is like, they say that they're no longer this. So let's give them a chance. Whereas it also like opens by letting down our guard, that opens us up, and particularly marginalized communities that are the targets of these people, opens them up to more abuse and more disbelief. And it's not restorative. And so, yeah, I wonder if you could talk a little bit more. I mean, I just kind of like blathered about it, but if you could talk a little more about the compassion narrative, as you call it, and like why it's promoted as the only appropriate social response if the state is the criminal, like the meter out of the criminal side of things, why it's okay for people to have a compassionate response, but it's not okay for other forms of resistance.
So yes, the language of compassion and forgiveness, both of those terms have been very big in this de-radicalization CVE world. It was kind of the slogan or the mission statement for a while of Life After Hate, which was the first major de-radicalization organization in the US and then still exists, but has split up in various different directions. I think that language is actually very potentially harmful. And at first I thought it was very sweet when I was getting into this work, you know, like 7 or 8 years ago. And then I started to see how that kind of language of compassion and forgiveness has been weaponized in various ways by the right and by people who are very naive about the kinds of boundaries that are needed to keep communities safe. And I totally agree with you. You know, I guess I agree with myself because you were quoting me, but I agree that forgiveness gets emphasized in a very Christian way. And we could certainly create a more complex Christian understanding of what forgiveness is. But I think the naive understanding of forgiveness from a Christian perspective is that forgiveness is obligated morally, that everyone should be forgiven. Certainly, if they apologize, they should be immediately forgiven. And that if you're not forgiving them immediately, you're morally inferior in some way. And that also forgiveness is healing and beneficial for the person who forgives, which psychologically we know is not necessarily the case, that people who've suffered abuse and trauma, often forgiveness can make them feel unsafe. It can make them feel less worthy. It can delegitimize their rightful anger that they're trying to process. And, you know, whether that's something that people want to work towards or not, I think is an open question. But it would definitely be more about the individual. And it's definitely not how we fix a social problem like fascism. And then exactly the dynamic plays out exactly as you said, where if forgiveness is held up, both as how we stop fascism and how we prevent it, and the morally superior approach, and how the individual heals who's been targeted by hate, then anyone who's questioning of the story of formers, or of the accountability level of formers, or the sincerity of a former, is then immediately suspect, because they're seen as undermining the very thing that stops fascism and hate, which is forgiveness, right? Or compassion. The compassion language, there are these kind of compassion stories that I studied, and there are many different, and it's also in the forthcoming Ethics of Researching the Far Right book that I'm doing with some folks in the UK through University of Manchester Press. But the compassion narrative goes something like this, right? It's a genre of story told by almost every former, which begins with, you know, all of the problems in their life and trying to fulfill their needs by joining a hate group, becoming enraged. And then there's always some sort of point at which the compassionate outreach of someone from a group they were targeting and who they hated transforms their heart, right? So they're sort of like shocked. There's this cognitive dissonance, like, how can this Jewish person be nice to me, a white person? Or how can this Black person be nice to me, a Nazi, or whatever? And there's this kind of shock and like, oh, I must be wrong about everything. And then this dismantling of the worldview and commitment to change and so forth. Usually this is factually just not what happens. Not that people are necessarily lying. And in some cases, they're just sort of backfilling their memories with the story they've been told is the actual thing that happened. But it's much more complex than that. Usually people's lives are falling apart. You know, they're scared of going to jail, or their organization is disintegrating, or they're just completely burned out, or they want to be able to get a job, but they've been doxxed and this sort of thing, right? People's lives are in disarray and they're like, oh, maybe I should reevaluate belief system. Just like, I mean, it's, you know, I think there's a lot of differences with addiction. I don't think hate is an addiction, but just like people, you know, sort of hitting rock bottom with an addiction, right? It's more like that than it is this kind of compassionate outreach. But when we keep feeding the public these stories and keep holding up formers as the experts on hate, what we're essentially telling people is the boundaries that are keeping your community safe are actually what's encouraging fascism. So you need to do outreach to people who are highly dangerous, or if you are not willing to do this kind of self-sacrificial noble thing and reach out to Nazis, then you need to step back and let the only people who are able to do that, which it just happens to turn out to be is, you know, like soft power and cops and social workers and people who are not fundamentally about empowering or liberating your community from the oppression it faces. So it's a very, very, very conservative, very, very disempowering area. It's very gaslighting. But it takes a while for people to see that and make that switch. And so I wish, you know, like, I wish people would be more thoughtful about platforming formers, you know, whether it's, you know, a synagogue or a university or, you know, whatever sort of nonprofit. There's this wanting to show people kindness, wanting to give people a chance, and thinking that this is this kind of heartwarming redemption story that will help people. And I think people are just very naive about the harm you can actually do by taking someone who's been involved in that level of damage to other people and then holding them up and saying, look at this, you know, new source of information, this new expert and their message. It can be really damaging. And so I've also discouraged people at various points in time from inviting formers as speakers. I think everyone needs to be more reflective about that.
Yeah.
And just because somebody's been out of the movement for 10 or 20 or 30 years does not mean they're an expert and does not mean they've processed and thought through and understood what they were involved in and what they did. And even if they have endorsements from the Simon Wiesenthal Center, like Scoop, or, you know, the ADL, or, you know, some sort of highly established seeming organization, that in itself also does not mean that there's any sort of guarantee that this person's done the work or can do it in a way that's not harmful to people.
Remember, kids, just because a story scratches that Dickens itch does not mean that it's like, does not mean that it's true.
Right.
The society that we live in is alienating on a lot of different levels, and the people process it in a different, a lot of different ways. And there's a strength in creating narratives that help people join together and figure out the stories that they're telling each other, and hopefully stories that are based on reality and not just what immediately feels good. I think there's a lot of reasons that people get drawn towards belief sets that are different from society's, what the capitalist state in the U.S. tells us as to why the world is the way it is and how to feel about how we feel about it. And I think that you make the point in the book a few times, as well as like at the beginning of this chat, none of us are just anti-fascists because we have a negative perception in our head of something that we're countering, but because we have visions of how the world could be. Can you speak about examples that you've seen as successful in countering fascist organizing and defending the intended targets of fascist attention and violence? And will you speak to the role of social movements constructing alternatives to the world that makes fascism currently prolific, hopefully making fascism impossible?
Yes. I mean, when I look at individual community responses, I'm constantly impressed by how well just local activist groups, just local people who may not be, you know, highly experienced with researching fascist movements or anything like that, are able to just do the work themselves. There are certainly pitfalls people fall into, but I've just seen community after community drawing smart boundaries, protecting and caring for people who are being targeted, stating their values clearly, fighting for more than just their own defense, not falling into just being on the back foot constantly of defending themselves, but also fighting for a vision of a world they want. I think people really can do this work. And so I really try to encourage them to not feel like they need to be experts or rely on experts or rely on policing or any of these institutions that we've been criticizing here. People do have the resources and the skill sets in their communities to do this work. I think long term, if we want to do more than just sort of constantly play whack-a-mole on each new fascist incursion, we have to be thinking about what draws people into fascist movements. And that's why I do think when we do the psychology piece correctly, we're not falling into liberalism or we're not defending CVE programs. If we actually understand the ways in which people are grasping for meaning and the ways in which that is accentuated by capitalism and by oppression in society. And when I say that, I don't mean that fascists are poor, because they're often not. Like oftentimes they're middle class, or middle class is a weird category, but you know, sometimes these are kids from suburbia or whatever, right? Or sometimes they're rich, you know, like Stephen Miller or whatever. But I think the escape from freedom that people are falling into, the desire to find meaning and the absence of that meaning, the absence of any social structures where people can come together and take care of one another and explore meaning and purpose together, the absence of that social network in modern society is really leaving people grasping for a place to belong and for a story that gives their lives meaning. And so it's very important on the left that we start creating, even more than we have thus far, spaces where people can come together and do that. And I think that includes being open to the arts and to spirituality and to philosophy in the broad sense of these terms. And then also, can we come together and meet each other's needs in the broader sense of needs, right? So some of that is aid. You know, we think about like the history of the Black Panther Party providing free lunches, that sort of programming, I think is really important. And one of the signs that I think that it's effective is that the far right tries to co-opt it, that we see militias and fascist organizations attempting to do these things, usually quite poorly, but occasionally well. And so we need to make sure we're not ceding that ground to them. that we are also engaged in the work of building now the systems and structures that we hope to see in the future.
Cool. Well, Joan, thank you very much for this conversation. Your next book is going to be coming out from University of Manchester, right? I know that we're running short on time, but I wonder if, could you give like a brief descriptor of what the book is and when it's going to be coming out?
Yeah, it's a huge anthology of pieces by various scholars and activists and some early career scholars, some people that have been at this for quite a while, talking about the ethics of researching the far right. A lot of what we're doing there, so the other editors are Antonia Vaughn, Megan Tinsley, and Aurelian Mondon. And, you know, I feel really honored to be able to participate as much as I did, and I wish I had done even more. But I'm glad to have been part of this really important project. And I think one of the most important things that comes up in that book, for me, at least from the standpoint of my research, is really good critiques that people are doing of participant observation. Because oftentimes in the social sciences, you're trained to do participant observation. And the ethics of researching a group, if you're like an anthropologist trying to understand another culture, for example, it's very different when you're talking about Nazis, right? Like you don't want to befriend them. You don't want to enter their worldview. You don't want to participate in their flyering and their marches and all of this stuff. You want to be careful you're not actually helping them, right? You're actually researching them to undermine them. And it's important to have that sense of purpose, that this is not just an objective activity, like, these people seem interesting and peculiar. What is their culture? But rather putting your research in the service of the good of society and making sure that you're undermining the people you're researching has a different ethics to it than certain other kinds of research.
Cool. When is that book slated to come out?
Very soon, March.
Cool.
I forget what day in March, but in March.
That's exciting. And folks can also find one of Joan's pieces in No Pass Iran through AK Press that came out October of 2022. But yeah, Joan, thank you again for participating in this conversation and contributing all these great ideas. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much. This was fun. Thanks for having me.
My pleasure. And now some words from anarchist prisoner Sean Swain.
76 people in the U.S. were killed in mass shootings in the month of July 2023. That same month, 110 people were killed by cops, according to an incomplete list compiled by the Washington Post. These are their names: Wendell Dalton, Lance Aguilar, Tavon Durantes Rutherford, Sean M. Burke, Jawan J. Dallas, Sam Knight, John Vincent Dye, Robbie Thomas Saunders, George Bell, Derek Diaz, Sean T. Hubert, Wesley Scott Taylor, Jarrell Garris, Lance Daniel Paxton, Ahmad Jalil Abdullah, Juan Diego Bernal Uriar, Frankie J. Cope, Randy Allen Jackson, Greg Covey, name withheld, July 4th, Westminster, Colorado, Barry Eugene Phillips, Ricky Wayne Franks, Billy Jaquan Smith, Bronche Minter, name withheld, July 5th, Bel Air, Kansas, Anthony J. Rios Jr., Abdisamad Ishmael, Sean Gagne, Andra Farnell Craig, Somchan Samsanath, Stephen Sam Kirkman, Duterval Sejour, Matthew Briggs, Esteban De Jesus Jr., Antoine Lindsay, Jessica Denise Brown, Charlie Foster, Garen Andrew Patty, Isidra Clara Castillo, Andrew Scott Norton, Salvador Manso Jr., Charles Byers, name withheld, July 9th, Mescalero Apache Reservation, New Mexico, Anthony Lyon, Jeremiah Wise, Sarah Wiedemann Ramos, Mark Buchanan, Jamal Brown, Jabari Cameron Bozeman, Daniel Sheehan, Andrew Harrington, Jeremiah Ladner, Robert Fledemeyer Brown, Mario Ortega, Rachel A. Ellis, Mohammed Barakat, Gregory Don Bratcher Jr., Kenan Anderson Sr., name withheld, July 15th, Inverness, Florida, Andre Lloyd Longmore, Cheroid Henrance Bell, Adrian San Martin, name withheld, July 16th, Las Cruces, New Mexico, Dietrich Williams Jr., Andrew Muggs, Armando Reyes, Norman Edward Dawson, Willis Thomas Jr., Tony R. Roy III, Victor T. Harris Jr., Scott Arthur O'Brien, Ernesto Edward Gonzalez, Joshua Ringel, Matthew Joseph Demas, Justin Scott Lance, Emmanuel Galaviz Campos, James Woodrone, name withheld, July 20th, Los Angeles, California, Matthew DeAndre Norwood, D'Antonior Stalling, Thomas Curtis Sizemore, Taylor Lee Richard Drew, Manny Jesus Rodriguez, Franklin Castro Ordonez, Poniox Canes Calles, Frank Foss Jr., John William Stockton, Dominic Hogans, Stephen Lawrence Tropia, Mavic Ariola, Alicia Duran, Christopher W. Fortin, Bryant Bluford, Reverend Tommy Jackson, Macy Juker, Nydia Nieves, Darren Young, David Wilson Guilbo, Tracy Dorpat, Joseph Higinio Arriaga, DeMarcus Clark, Freddie Walker, Esteban Alegria Hurtado, Kyle Larkin, Ronaldo Alvarado, David McClure, Andrew Wesley Dix, David R. Sandifer Jr., Joseph Rudolph Steiger, Ricky Thomas Cobb II. This is anarchist prisoner Sean Swain from the Super Duper Uber Mega Ultra Hyper Turbo Multi Maxi Max in Youngstown, Ohio. If you're listening, you are the resistance.
You can still write Sean at his new old new again address at Sean Swain number A243205 OSP Youngstown 878 Coitsville Hubbard Road, Youngstown, Ohio 44505. You can find his past writings, updates on his case, hear his past audio, find out how to get his books, plus ways to contribute to his legal defense fund at seanswain.org.
This is The Final Straw Radio. The show will later be archived at thefinalstrawradio.noblogs.org, and you can email us with questions and suggestions at thefinalstrawradio@riseup.net or thefinalstrawradio@protonmail.com. If you'd like to use any episode for your project or radio show, feel free to do so. Just send us an email to let us know. If you care to, you can send us letters at TFSR, P.O. Box 6004, Asheville, North Carolina, 28816. Programming support is brought to you by Firestorm Books. Located at 1022 Haywood Road in West Asheville, Firestorm is a bookstore and social movement space owned by its workers in operation since 2008. Their event calendar and complete catalog of books can be found online at firestorm.coop.